It's my pleasure to introduce Henrik to you. He has been following Troopers for quite some years, but hasn't attended until last year. And I was following, given my own background is on networking, I was following his research for a while. And when I became aware of this one, I was immediately, okay, I know you want to come back to Troopers. Here's a chance, even as a speaker. And I reached out, like, Henrik, please file this. And for historical reasons, I have a free wildcards in the, say, CFP process, and I used one of this. I wanted to see this here. So in case you don't like it, which I do not extend, expect, as I know this is great stuff, it would be me to blame. But I'm happy you're here, and I really look forward to this one. Henrik, stage is yours.
Thank you so much for the nice words and using the wildcard. I'm really happy to be back in Heidelberg at the Troopers conference. I've been reading about Troopers for years, following some of the presentations, and I should have gone much earlier. And every year from now, I will be going to Troopers, paid or unpaid, or CFP status or whatever. I really like the family and things that is going on here. So my name is Henrik Lund Kramshøj. I'm from Copenhagen, which you probably can hear from the accent. I'm also called Kramse, so that's my nickname and my Twitter handle. And I have to say immediately that the slides are already available as PDF, and they are also open source, so you can take anything from that repo on a very open license and reuse, remix, do whatever you like. So this presentation is about VXLAN. VXLAN is a tunneling protocol. It's very insecure. It's very insecure and was just dreamt up by a few people on a napkin, I guess. And a lot of network people actually know that it is insecure, but more people should know that it's insecure. So I'm really happy to see you here, that you're going to spend the next hour where we're going to talk about how we can bend VXLAN, how we can subvert it using spoofed packets, what can we do with these spoofed packets. We can often say that this technology is insecure, but sometimes we need a proof of concept to actually tell people how insecure and what can happen, what are the consequences if we use this insecure technology. And we are using a lot of insecure technologies, but we have to limit and restrict and reduce. So VXLAN is something you may want to use, but you should use it in a good way. You should know what the problems are and how you maybe can reduce the problems. So I'm going to include some example scripts and sample attacks that I have shown in customer networks. I didn't say much about my background. I'm a network and security guy in Copenhagen, freelance, doing building and testing of networks. And I have some customers, and these customers wanted to see what could be done if this risk materializes. So I have selected a few scripts. It's only a little sample of what can be done, and your creativity can maybe bring this further. And I would also like to talk to some of you people about how we can take this further, how can we scan for these issues, how can we improve this, how can we report it back to the customers, to the networks, to the people that are using VXLAN. I'm going to give a little bit of pointers to offensive tools and defensive tools. That's one of the things I like about Troopers, that we really do both offense and defense. That's really great, making the world a safer place. This mostly works because you can still spoof packets. And spoofing packets on the internet is, of course, interesting. And that is something that people have fought with in many years in the network communities that Eno and me are part of. And even though some customers and some networks actually prevent spoofing from the outside, it's really hard to also prevent spoofing from the inside. And when we talk about these VXLAN spoof packets, think of them as coming from both inside and outside, and from virtual machines and from customer machines and machines that you do not administer, you do not control. So spoof packets can come from everywhere. And if they can reach these, what is called a VXLAN endpoint, then it can be used for bad things. So this VXLAN technology is a tunneling encapsulation network virtualization technology. It uses VLAN encapsulation, and it connects different layer 2 networks. So it's something that a lot of people want to do, and we have a lot of the big vendors. There's a list of vendors up here, VMware, Arista, Cisco, all of these companies, they are pushing their solutions, and it is already being used in production. The RFC is from 2014, so it is something that is out there. It's implemented in the Linux kernel, it's implemented in OpenBSD, FreeBSD. You can go home and set up a network in less than 15 minutes. So you can actually connect two devices to Linux machines in less than 15 minutes because it's only a few commands. And then there's the security part, but don't worry about that. The reason I do this talk is that we see all these vendors that hype their speed of VXLAN implementation. So one of the hardware vendors that I have worked with, they have Arista switches that are layer 3 switches, can do BGP and routing and all sorts of stuff. And they also have hardware virtualization using VXLAN. So they can handle wire speed packets coming in, decapsulate them, and put them onto a network. And in the other end, they can encapsulate on wire speed. So they have chips that do these things, which is great. It's great. We can use wire speed 10 gigabit and probably 100 gigabit when that comes. But they don't stress any of the security issues. So a lot of these big companies, if you go to the web pages, go to their manuals, they say how to configure this, how to install it, but not how to secure it. And we need to secure VXLAN networks. So we are seeing new networks being built insecurely. We are also seeing a lot of blog posts that I really hate, because that's something like you can connect your on-premise cloud to VXLAN through VXLAN to your Amazon cloud. There was even a blog post that I read yesterday trying to just catch up on some of the news. It was how to connect your AWS cloud with your Google cloud using VXLAN, which is insecure. Blog post, I think. We also need to increase visibility into VXLAN attacks, because if people are using these attacks, and somebody may be using it, then you need to make sure that your intrusion detection system, your network monitoring, can handle these VXLAN packets. And I'm an open source guy, and I use a lot of intrusion detection systems, network monitoring systems. Some of my preferred ones are Suikata, EDS, and the Seek, the formerly known as Bro, the IDS and framework. And they didn't understand VXLAN at all. So it's like ships in the night. You cannot see this traffic, so you don't even know if somebody's using these for attacks. So if you use VXLAN across data centers, you have a really complex problem, and I don't have all the solutions. I actually need help in designing what I would call network patterns so we can do good VXLAN deployments. So for those of you that haven't met VXLAN before, it's the idea of connecting these two data centers. We have a data center 1, data center 2. We have a host 1, host 2. They are in different centers. They're called 10.0.0.10, 10.0.0.20, and we want these to connect somehow. It may be that these data centers are close together, then you can just take a fiber. But if they're further apart, it makes it very inconvenient to have a single fiber, a single point of failure. So instead of connecting with a fiber, you can use this VXLAN technology. The VXLAN technology is implemented in these blue boxes, which is often a switch, and I will think of it as an Arista switch today. And there's no evil thoughts against Arista. It could just as well be another vendor. But the blue device is encapsulating the traffic. So we see a packet coming from host 1, reaches the blue device, it gets put into an UDP packet. So UDP packets have a data field. They can transfer anything. So we can take an Ethernet frame with VLAN information, put it into UDP. Then the UDP is forwarded with an IP header, and it's routed across the internet or some kind of network. And do it across the internet is maybe not the best idea, because it's very insecure, as I will say in just a moment. So when we forward it across the internet, route it, it reaches the other data center, the other blue box. The other blue box takes this IP packet with the UDP header, takes the data. Oh, the data is a frame, it's an Ethernet frame, forwards it onto the VLAN, which is the destination. And on that destination VLAN, we will have this host 2 that just received an Ethernet frame. So more or less, it is as if the whole network, the whole internet, is just a switch where these two, host 1 and host 2, are in different switch ports. So they can communicate directly using all the normal protocols that we know. And most often there's also VLANs involved in this, but I haven't shown it in the drawing. So what about security? This is how it works. It encapsulates in UDP. UDP can get lost. That's one of the problems. But then you have to resend it. The same on an Ethernet. You can lose a packet, and you have to resend it. But the worst thing about VXLAN is that it, by itself, it doesn't provide any security. There's no encryption. There's no confidentiality. There's no integrity protection. It's just a UDP packet with some data. So if you want to protect your network, if you want to protect your data center too, you need to make sure that only data from data center one can reach this data center. And you can try to do this with a firewall. You can try to put on a router ACL so you have the IP address from data center one sending you packets, so you only allow packets from that IP from that network. You can also try to isolate so nobody from the outside, if you're routing this across your own network, it may be possible to isolate so nobody from the outside internet can send to your devices in data center two. But that's really difficult. You can use a lot of VRF, you can maybe use an MPLS cloud, you can do something, but it's not obvious how to secure this, because then you have inside your data center, you have inside your network, you might have customers, you might have partners, you have your servers that can get hacked. And hacking a server and enable it to send UDP is not that hard. So if you own a server in a network that uses VXLAN, it might be possible to spoof packets from that entry point. So it's not easy. It's not easy. And I think we have huge gaps in understanding these issues. A lot of times we are busy. We need to make something work. It has to go fast. So we set it up. It works. It's fine. And in the old days, and in some of my previous jobs, and some of the research by Eno actually, they have described how you can inject things with MPLS, how you can use GRE, another tunneling protocol, and you can use IPv6 in the old days before firewalls and intrusion detection systems understood IPv6. You could use IPv6 for bad purposes, and that is the same with VXLAN. So if you have a network that doesn't look for the VXLAN packets, it's very easy to send them, and they're kind of invisible in that network. If you ask the vendors, they have some security documents. Arista has a whole page about VXLAN security. I found a 2018 55-page VXLAN EVPN site design and deployment with a lot of graphs and a lot of drawings. It didn't have the word security in any place in that 55-page PDF. Not a single word, not a single sentence, not a warning, nothing. So security is not detailed as part of the regular how to set up VXLAN, and we need to change that. So to recap what I've been saying until now is that, is it possible to produce VXLAN packets which sent across the internet will be accepted, injected, decapsulated onto a layer two, which might be behind a firewall and is invisible to other security devices and around other security devices? And exactly that is what I'm saying. So, and a lot of network people have been saying this, and I got some flack for posting this and saying this and presenting this, because some network people, and maybe Ivan is in the room, we were talking about getting a beer here. There's a guy called Ivan, and we talked about getting a beer at Troopers because he knew, and he has been posting blog posts about this for years, but nobody has done anything about it. So what I'm going to talk about now is I will describe how I met this, how I abused this, and first part is the VXLAN injection. So we need to understand that we have the setup with the two data centers. We have tried our best to allow only traffic coming from the 192.0.2.10, the blue device on the left, to send traffic to the other one in the other data center. So we might have an ACL that prevents us from all of the internet to send traffic to data center two. But what happens if I have a server on the upper left, which is available on the internet? It can send spoof packets. It's not that hard to find a network. Actually, I could do it from the normal place where I have my servers. They didn't have any protection, so I could spoof my packets. So I'm spoofing packets coming from 192.0.2.10, which is the same IP as the blue box on the left. So when these packets reach on the other data center on the blue box following the red line, then actually it looks like it's coming from data center one. And since there's no integrity protection in the VXLAN, there's no way of distinguishing between a spoof packet that I'm sending and a regular packet from the other data center, it will get accepted. So, and actually in wire speed, so it's getting handled by some hardware chips in the switch on the right. I did these tests first in a small network, trying to replicate, see if I could send some spoof packets. Then I moved over to this pen test server in another network. So the attacks that I'm describing has been tested both in the lab with a few devices on a table, but it has also been tested from a pen test server in one AS number, in one AS network, across an internet exchange, to a big network, and then into the VXLAN environment that was insecure to begin with. And there's no reason this shouldn't work, even across countries from far away on the internet, because the VXLAN is only IP UDP packets. So we are used to seeing these. It's a standard protocol. The only non-standard part is the data field of the UDP packet, which contains Ethernet frames. When we look into these VXLAN packets, it has a header. It has a header where you have some special fields that need to be set. There's an I on the upper left that needs to be set. That's a single bit. You also have something called the VNI, the VXLAN network identifier. It allows a lot of different values to be set, which enhances your possibility to use a lot of VLANs across the same infrastructure. So you can use 4,000 VLANs in this part and 4,000 VLANs in this part and 4,000 in this part and send it across the same VXLAN infrastructure. But in most cases, the cases I have seen, and I would be happy if you would protest and come to me later and say if it's not the same in your networks, but most often the VNI and the VLAN is the same. So in my experiments, I would consider this a field that has the values from 1 to 4,000, more or less. Then you have what is called the inner Ethernet header. So you have the outer packet, you have the inner packet, and the inner Ethernet header is just like a regular Ethernet packet. So you will have the source and the destination MAC addresses, the hardware addresses, the ones we know already. You would have an optional tag with VLAN, and then you would have the Ether type. And the Ether type will allow you to use IPv6 and IPv4. And I'm afraid the examples are only IPv4, but think of it as anything we do can be done on IPv6 too. And I'm a big fan of IPv6. So using VXLAN, using this header, producing packets with this, you can inject ARP traffic, you can inject TCP traffic, you can inject UDP traffic. And if you're sending ARP traffic, that makes it possible for you to do all the bad stuff that we know from LANs. So suddenly you can, from the outside, across the internet, in a separate country even, send traffic that ends up as ARP traffic that can quickly lead to connectivity DOS. I have done that a couple of times where I send the wrong packets and then the host cannot communicate. You can also send the same MAC address to both places so they both think the MAC address is at the other side and stuff like that. So these devices will also pick up some of the MAC addresses and some of the things that we know from a switch. So a normal regular switch will know which MAC addresses is on each port. And in the VXLAN implementations, the switches will know which MAC addresses, which hosts are local and which are remote. So you can mess a lot with this. You can also inject TCP traffic like SYN flooding. So you can send SYN floods across the internet from a faraway country. It goes directly to the VXLAN device. It does not hit the firewall on the way, or maybe it does, but the firewall will just allow it in. And for speed purposes, you would often have your VXLAN outside of the firewall or in parallel with the firewall. Your anti-DDoS devices will probably not look at this traffic. So you have a situation where it's possible to do wire speed SYN flooding to the actual hosts on the LAN network behind the firewall and security devices. That's not good. You can also inject UDP packets, and that is some of the examples I'm going to show today because they are the most simple ones, where you inject UDP packets, and if your source IP in the UDP packet in the request gets a response, that response is forwarded to you out through the regular infrastructure on site. So in most cases, because you are using these spoof packets, you won't get a response back through VXLAN, so you will inject one way and you will receive through another route. So it's asymmetric routing in that sense. And depending on your firewall and security devices and your policies, it may not be possible to get everything outside, get every response out. But as you will see, some examples are really nice. The first example I will use and explain is this one where we are reading it from the top and then counterclockwise. So we have the internet in the middle, we have the blue router VXLAN device, and I have to explain a name, which is, it's called a VXLAN tunnel endpoint. So if I'm saying VTEP, I mean a VXLAN tunnel endpoint. So the blue device is a tunnel endpoint. It receives the VXLAN traffic. So I'm the attacker on the top, coming from this .666 machine. I'm sending spoof packets, and inside these are DNS requests. So a regular UDP port 53 DNS request. I'm sending it to the blue device. The blue device unpacks it and sends it on to the destination. And in my case, I knew that I had a DNS server on 10.0.0.10, so I could send a DNS request to that IP address. Unfortunately, if you're on the outside, you may not know the MAC address of the destination. But let's try. We're just sending it to the MAC destination address, the broadcast MAC address, FFFFFF. So that's fine. Let's try it. Send that traffic. And I could monitor that the traffic was getting decapsulated, it was getting forwarded onto the VLAN, and it actually reached the server. Whee! So we could see that actually our example is working. We could get the traffic. UDP traffic, a DNS request to the broadcast MAC address to a server which is running a DNS server on that port. Does that work? How many of you know DNS and operating systems? I didn't know this, and I've been working with DNS and operating system for many years, but actually a UDP service such as DNS that receives an Ethernet frame destined for the broadcast MAC address will pick up the request and respond. So that's fantastic. We don't need to know the destination MAC address. So in this case, the internal DNS sees it as a valid request, and it probably may have some ACLs, but it's on the inside of the firewall, so why would it have an ACL? It's only being used by the local servers. If it doesn't have any ACLs, it will respond with the blue line going up to the top, and because I set my source address in the inner packet, I get a response. So by now, using VXLAN across the internet, we can do DNS requests. That's fine, that's great. So, and note, this server does not have an external IP. It does not have any port forwardings. It's only because of the VXLAN decapsulation happening with the spoof packets. And I tested this working with Clavister firewalls. It's a Swedish firewall brand. It's probably not very popular around the world, but they don't have any DNS UDP inspection. So it just sees a UDP packet, says, oh, it's coming from the inside. Everything from the inside is allowed out. And that's a very common way to do this. Even if, say, I was not allowed on sending out to this IP address, it might be possible to use another port. I can set the source port in my request, and the server will respond back to that. That becomes the destination for the answer. So I not just need to find some policy that allows me to send traffic out. To do this, I actually cooked up a couple of SCAPI scripts, and it was very easy. It was surprisingly easy. So by defining a VXLAN port, there are two ports that are being used. There's the one from the standard 8.4.7.8.9, and there's a Linux kernel default of 8.4.7.2. So either one of these two ports. Then I need to guess a VNI or just produce all the packets with this VNI. The VXLAN variable contains the outer part of this packet that I'm going to send. So this one has the source and destination from the VTEPs, the blue devices. So I'm spoofing this packet using the source and destination from the blue devices. I'm using a VXLAN header with this flag set. That was the I in the header that we showed earlier. And then I start building the inner packet. So the inner packet will use the broadcast MAC as the destination. It will just use a random MAC as the source. There's no reason to know the source MAC address because the device will pick up an IP packet and then it will just send it back through IP and that will generate a new MAC destination. So this is just a random MAC that I typed in. Then I have my attacker IP address where the responses are to be sent and the destination is the host on the inside running the DNS service. And again, a lot of people use the 10/8 and that's a lot of IP addresses, but then again, it's not that many IP addresses. I'm preparing the part of where we talk about scanning for this. So I could perhaps scan for the whole 10/8 network using DNS and at least find the DNS servers. With these variables, I can just use the SCAPI library. In the SCAPI library, you can take the packet and create it from the VXLAN we had on the top, then add an Ethernet packet with the IP packet, with a UDP, with a DNS request. So in this case, I'm just using more or less regular SCAPI commands and sending this on actually worked. When I saw this working with the broadcast MAC address, I asked some of my friends and it turns out that unbound, unopened BSD will reply to this. And when asked, they confirm this is how it is supposed to work. So there's nothing special in this. There's no vulnerability in unbound. There's no problem in OpenBSD. This is how it's supposed to work. And that helps a lot because then I don't need to generate all the destination MAC addresses for this to work. That's fine. We can do single DNS requests. Great. But what about receiving? So when we're receiving this, it comes from another IP address. And it comes to our port. The one that we set as the source port in the request becomes the destination in the response. So I did a little more Python. I'm not really a programmer, as you might be able to know. So I set up a parent that can do some sniffing. I knew that it would be UDP. It would come to this port 54,040, and it would probably come from this network that I'm attacking. So it's probably coming from this /24. And that is because a lot of times, a lot of places, this will go through the firewall, and going out through the firewall, it will be netted. So I will not receive it from 10.0.0.10, but I will receive it from the firewall, which is in front of the server. But I know probably it will come from this network, it will be this port, it will be UDP. And then we can start sending these packets. You can send one packet, you can send multiple packets. As we know, the vendors are very proud of their wire speed, and that actually works. So that was fine. But I want to do something more. I want to do it a little bit more easy for myself. So what happens when we actually send these DNS requests? So this is very similar to the first example, but in my case, now I recognize that the DNS request sent, or any UDP probe actually, we might be able to extend this to any service that uses UDP and gets a response with UDP. So it sends out the response through the firewall. When it sends it out through the firewall, we can actually receive it on the attack machine, and the attack machine can then reverse it and then send other requests with UDP to that combination of IP that we got it from and the port we got it from. And the reason is that the outgoing UDP response generates state in the firewall. So by having this state, and that state will exist for some time, a couple of minutes, depends on the firewall implementation, But in many cases, a firewall will not know if there's a session that is closed because UDP doesn't have sessions. So regular firewall will just have the state open for a number of seconds, 300 seconds. So I have 300 seconds in Python to produce a response, another packet, and send it back to the network. And that actually goes across the normal internet. So now we don't need the VXLAN anymore. We only use it as a crowbar to open the firewall, and then we can start sending requests. And sending these requests also work. So now we have a method of opening the network from the inside through the firewall, and we can start doing a lot of DNS brute force. We can ask it anything we want on this internal DNS. And again, this was tested working with Clavister as the firewall. It has very weak no DNS inspection, but depending on your firewall, your implementation, some of it might not work, some of it might need some tweaking. I also haven't tried all UDP services, but I think there's a real possibility of being able to send in traffic, send it to a broadcast MAC address, getting some kind of response, and then you can start sending traffic back again. And even better if we could get find a service with UDP that makes every machine on the local network respond. And if we're using IPv6, I haven't tried it yet, it's on my to-do list, but that might make it possible to scan the network more or less because we're using this LAN technology which allows the broadcast. So these are the main examples that I'm using in this, and I hope you can see that this has the potential for some damage in the networks, especially since these devices on the internal LAN, they do not have an open IP, public IP. They don't have ports forwarded. They may be more loose in their configuration. If you set up an Active Directory server, how tight is the security on that inside the network? And we also have the possibility of doing what we call VLAN hopping. So actually, if we get this far, we can select which VLAN we are attacking. We don't have to go through the firewall. This just goes through the blue device, the switch, the tunneling endpoint. Again, the Python to do this is amazingly simple. So we had all this fork and things, and we receive the response. We just take the data, the IP and the UDP, and then we just turn it around and we can start doing another DNS request. So we can do a DNS request with localhost. We can start doing reverse DNS so we can map out the local network. We can perhaps even get to a place where we can do a zone transfer even. Zone transfer would require TCP. And I haven't got a working example yet with splicing TCP connections, but it might be possible and would probably be more specific to the firewall used, but it might be possible to send some kind of TCP SYN in this direction through the network. And since I know all the information, I can of course respond back with my SYNAG packet. So it might be possible to do a TCP connection opening this way, but I cannot access this server with the same TCP connection unless I also open the connection on that host. So I have to like send TCP SYN packets that go out through the network and then send some to the internal host and then splice it up later. It might be doable, but I'm not skilled enough to do that yet. Yeah, and also we have a lot of other complex protocols, SIP, FTP. There's a lot of these protocols, and UPnP is being used a lot in the consumer space, but FTP, SIP, voice protocols, there's a lot of protocols that actually have these application layer gateways, these inspection mechanisms in the firewalls, and it might be possible to abuse those a bit so we can open connections coming into the network. So that's also one of the research directions that you might go into. Some of you may object already and say, this is not possible. You would need too much information. There's just too many possibilities and combinations for the local IP, the port numbers, the VNIs, and in some cases, you would need to spoof the pair of IP addresses from the VTAP source and the VTAP destination, the data center one, data center two. If we look into this, in many cases, you don't need the IPs of the two routers. A lot of the examples that I have seen and the setups that I have seen, they do not limit who can send VXLAN traffic. And that sounds a bit crazy because then you can just use your regular source on the internet or any source IP on the internet. And then you just need to generate the IP of the destination tunnel endpoint. Fine. Then we have the VNI, which is usually the VLAN. So in my case, I would say that's 4,000 combinations. 4,000 combinations is not really a lot. And using SCAPI, which is Python and pretty slow, I just checked yesterday that I can at least send 1,000 probes in 5 seconds. So doing a full scan using 4,000 packets, combination with the VNI switching would take less than a minute. And you could actually go a bit above the 4,000 if you want to check if they're using multiple parts of the VNI space, so to speak. Also, the internal subnets, if we look at these setups, it's probably bigger networks. It's probably not the home network. So if we disregard the 192.168 space and focus on the 172.16 private address space and the 10/8 private space, it's a lot of IPs, sure. But if we're sending, say, ping packets, it would be often assumed that the gateway is on .1. Or .254 if we're using /24s. So by using some assumptions, and just yesterday I was in the IPv6 scanning presentation, which was fantastic, where they used a lot of statistics to actually start scanning IPv6 space, which is crazy. So I feel confident that in this smaller space of having private RFC 1918 IP addresses, we could produce all the packets and do some scanning. The MAC addresses, I was thinking that would be a huge problem when I started out doing this because it's 48 bits and in some cases you might need to generate both the source and destination. It turns out the source is not relevant. I don't think I have seen a single use case where I need to set the correct source MAC address. So it's usually the destination MAC address. And the destination MAC address, I would focus more on these attacks, these examples where you use the broadcast MAC address. So that is actually also out of the equation. So I'm not going to do a math example and see how many combinations it is, but I would just say that we can do a lot of scanning, we can produce a lot of packets, and then we have another problem that the VTAPs don't regularly lock if something is wrong. So we can just start sending all these and there's no visibility into people doing this. There's no logs from the devices doing this. I was checking on Arista with the hardware VTAP, which is just a chip doing the decapsulation, and I haven't seen any logs on those. And I'm actually thinking of buying a device like that, but it's 1,500 euros, so it's kind of a big deal to buy this. You can also look at places where you could find this information. And as hackers, we know that often people combine and chain exploits and vulnerabilities. And we could try with the MAC addresses also to use something like VRP, which is a virtual routing protocol, where you have two devices that actually share the default gateway. So that might be a way to send it to the default gateway, very popular. An older one is the Cisco HSRP. So we have a MAC address that is more or less static. At least it's a smaller space than the full MAC address, 48-bit. We had this with the internal subnet. We have these qualified guesses as to the default gateways. .1 is very common. The port will probably be one of these two standard ports. You can select a different port, but people select the default ports anyway. And usually we cannot scan UDP on the internet, but in these cases, they might be further out onto the internet. And in some cases, they don't have proper filtering. So you might be able to scan for the port below 4788. And if you get a response on that, but you don't get a response on 89, then it might be that it's running VXLAN. So that might also help us, so we can try to do some scanning for that. A lot of this information that I used is also not considered highly confidential. So in many cases, people will have Stack Overflow questions where they have the IP addresses. A lot of places, some of our regular protocols like SMTP, HTTP often reveal the real IP address. If you have a web page on Apache, it will have this signature, which you should turn off, but a lot of people don't. We also have a lot of the load balancers, gateways, that actually puts in forwarded for, and we have the real IP of the node behind, because it's very nice for debugging purposes. So there's lots of ways we might be able, in a targeted attack, to actually use this. And it is possible to produce millions of packets. If we have tools and devices like MassScan can produce more than 10 million packets per second on just scanning. So with a high-powered server, it should probably be possible to produce 10 million or more packets per second, and that will allow us to scan huge areas of this space. Also, I have seen in my penetration testing, we have seen a lot of devices with SNMP public available, so you could do an SNMP walk. And if you get access to SNMP on a device, it will actually include most of this information, because that will have a local ARP table, it will have the switches forward table, which MAC addresses are on which ports. So getting access to that would get you most of the information. And as I said, the hardware VTAP on Arista doesn't lock much, if anything. Just as a question to the crowd, do you think this would be possible in a targeted test? Can I see some jazz hands? Some people are nodding, not a lot. It's close to lunch. I did some small testing. I haven't released a scanner on the internet yet because I'm a bit afraid what people would say. I'm pretty sure that it would be illegal in Denmark for me to inject packets on the LAN behind the firewall. I'm pretty sure that that's a bit deeper than doing a regular port scan. A port scan in Denmark can be legal if you don't intend to break in. But in this case, I'm actually accessing the internal LAN if it succeeds. And I am sending traffic through the firewall if it succeeds. So I haven't tried doing these scans on a large scale, but it would look something like this. So on this slide, I just took all the information from the previous slides, just added them together in one send, receive loop, more or less, and using this with the VXLAN VNI, switching from 1 to 1024 takes about 5 seconds to run on an old blade server that I have in a data center in Denmark. So it can be expanded. And I feel very confident that we could use other protocols than DNS. We could perhaps even use some of the Windows ports. We might be able to use ICMP v6. So I feel confident that maybe next year we will have some kind of scanner for doing scans on the internet for these vulnerable VTIPs. Also, I would like to try out some of these older attacks, some of the LAN attacks, try to do the attacks from afar, doing it across the internet. There's something called YesseniaNet, which has a lot of old attacks, which are local attacks. That would be interesting. But we also need to secure our networks better. We need to make sure that we have our server networks protected better. Running a host firewall is possible now. If you're using Ansible, just configure your Ansible to turn on the firewall and open for the services that you actually need from the places where you need it. And we're trying to brainstorm and enhance this into a bigger plan. Also, on the defensive side, I would propose that you start using Seek, start using Suricata, make sure that you tap the information going to the VXLAN endpoint if you have VXLAN in your network. It's not enough to just log from the firewall. You need to log from these devices. And if they don't log by themselves, just tap the traffic and decipher it. Unfortunately, neither Seek or Suricata supported this. So that's a bad thing, even if you were running it. But actually, 5 days ago, they actually pulled in a request into Seek. So I guess by the next major release, there will be support for VXLAN, so it can decode it and show that actually something is happening on this network, which I think is cool and great. I didn't do it. I have pushed a couple of people and tried making a pull request, but they modified it and improved it, and it got pulled in. Also, on the more offensive side, I have done a small fork of the HPing 3 tool. The HPing 3 tool is a packet generator that can generate packets, and just by adding some copy-paste to this tool, I could make it prepend the packets with a VXLAN header. So anything that HPing can do, HPing 3 can do, can be done with VXLAN packets now. And it's actually a tool that I use for DDoS testing, where we simulate a lot of traffic. So it's a tool that can send hundreds of thousands of packets per second. And it's written in C, and it's quite efficient. So that one can also be used for VXLAN testing. So if I need to demonstrate a Synflot, I would use that tool. If you're interested in one-way scenarios, it's also possible to just take a Linux kernel, Linux machine, and then configure the VXLAN interface on your local machine as if you had a partner. And as if you had a partner, and then just send the traffic into that interface, will get it encapsulated in VXLAN and sent across the internet. So in some cases, some of your tools can also just use the VXLAN built into the Linux kernel. And otherwise, SCAPI is very easy to get going. It takes a couple of hours playing with this. And it is my preferred way of doing it because you can receive the requests and mangle them and do something with them. And also, I have a patch to Suricata, but it's not really great. So that's the next step of expanding tool support so we can get some visibility into this. I'm getting close to the question time. So this is actually the last slide. And the lessons I've learned is that when you're using encapsulating and tunneling like VXLAN, think security. And I'm pretty old, so we were used to the DRE tunnels being protected by IPsec. That's the old way of doing tunneling. And it's quite scary to just meet this VXLAN, see it in production between devices that can do wire speed 10 gigabit and no locking at all. So even on your local networks, I would propose that you use TLS, you use encryption between servers on your LAN, and all of a sudden, this LAN might be a LAN in different places, in different data centers, connected with VXLAN. I also would like to know how we can secure our networks, and if you have an idea for securing it from the external internet, the internal hosts, and all of this, it's like, oh my God. And at least one recommendation is that you should all go home and make sure that you cannot spoof from your network, you cannot spoof into your network. So BCP is the best current practice about ingress and egress filtering on networks, and you should really consider that. And you could also do a lot in the routers that are close to your tunnel endpoints to make sure that at least you're not getting traffic spoofed from the inside of your own network. When you have the ACLs and the traffic going out from the virtualized servers, they cannot just return traffic back to your endpoint. Stuff like that might help a lot. There's also newer protocols, like this one called Genève, which actually has a proposal for encryption. And I think newer proposals and newer protocols, they probably have some kind of encryption. There's also something called MagSec. I didn't include it on slide. But there are some devices that can actually do encryption on layer 2. But a lot of these protocols are not being used. They're not understood. The algorithms are not always up to par with what we need and what we think about when talking about security. So that more or less concludes the presentation part.